Hello. Welcome back from afternoon tea to our awesome panel session this afternoon, where we are looking into the future of community efforts to protect free and open source software using legal tools. Now, we have an awesome panel, and I've asked them to introduce themselves. But very quickly, we have Deb Nicholson, Kate Chapman, Michael Cordover, and Richard Fontana. What I'm going to do is ask them to very briefly introduce themselves, just their name and affiliation, so you can boo if they go on for longer than that. And then I'm going to throw straight into a sort of clarifying question to kind of start to unpack what this question is all about. So, with no further ado, let's hear who these people are.
As Donna said, my name is Deb Nicholson. I work at the Open Invention Network, which is a defensive patent pool for Linux. And I also contribute to GNU Media Goblin, which is a project to decentralize media hosting.
Hi, I'm Kate. For work, I'm the Chief Technology Officer of the Cadasta Foundation. We use open source software to help communities document their land rights around the world. I also contribute to OpenStreetMap and serve as the chairperson of the board of directors of the OpenStreetMap Foundation.
I'm Michael Cordover. I've recently transitioned to being a software developer. I was previously an intellectual property lawyer, and I'm well known for my attempts to get the Electoral Commission to release Senate counting software.
Hi, I'm Richard Fontana. I'm a lawyer at Red Hat, and I also am a board director of the Open Source Initiative.
Thank you, everyone. Can we give them a warm welcome? So I wanted to kick off with a question really coming out of my own curiosity and ignorance. What do we mean by legal tools? Does anyone want to take that one first? Stunned silence from all of them.
I mean, I'll start by saying I think legal tools are things where we get to use the power of law, which is about being able to use force in order to change the landscape. So that can range from things like regulatory tools and laws through to things like software licenses and contractual arrangements, those types of things.
Anyone else want to add to that?
Well, in my mind, it's a kind of dialogues that interplay between what we want and what the government constrictions are and how we work within that. And so sometimes, kind of going on our conversation there earlier was, sometimes we work with the existing tools, sometimes we work against them, and sometimes we work despite them.
So when we talk about legal tools, I do, you know, sometimes hear, I think there's a whole tradition of talking about the resources that are available to people who are within a legal system as tools. I think it's usually talked about in a very positive way, but I think, you know, of course, any tool can be used for bad as well as good purposes, and that's certainly true of any of the tools that we, you know, in particular for free software and open source, any of the legal tools that we might be talking about probably have both a kind of a good purpose and a bad purpose depending on the context. Kind of obvious, but worth pointing out.
Okay, so this is a panel discussion, so I also am hoping that many of you in the audience might take this opportunity to ask some questions, so consider yourselves on notice to pose some questions, and please, if you can, if you're right up the back and you want to come forward to participate in the conversation a little more, please do, so that I also don't have to run around quite so much to get your question on the recording. So legal tools, regulations, some of them help, some of them hinder, so there's a sort of basis for the question, but what we're really talking about is protecting FOSS, protecting free and open source software. From what? What are the threats that we're facing that we need to be considering?
When I think about that, I think about sort of a large centralized corporate industry around software that often acts to crush out smaller players or players that have a more altruistic goal rather than a capitalistic goal. And so in my mind, when I think of protecting FOSS from who or what, it's those kinds of elements.
And a specific example of that relates to why Cadasta, where I work, exists. So most systems that are used for land records administration around the world are large proprietary IT systems. And what happens in emerging economies is a donor comes in and pays a huge amount of money to put in this IT system to track property records. And then a few different things happen. Corruption, the donor goes away and they can't afford the system anymore. The employees require a high level of training and go find other jobs. So we're small and we're trying to create simple systems that are easy to maintain, that you don't need a whole IT infrastructure. Those proprietary companies don't necessarily like us, you know, what we're trying and what we're trying to do. And so in the very beginning when choosing a license was thinking through what are the impacts of that and how, you know, we want communities to be able to modify and use our software and make that easy, but we don't necessarily want the corporations competing with us to easily try to come and essentially crush us. And for us, that legal tool is licensing under the AGPL. We provide a web system, because otherwise, I think we would just try to fly under the radar and hope no one noticed. So it's key for making sure our software is free and available to communities and we continue to exist.
Yeah, so licenses are kind of an obvious example of legal tools that are used in free software. And I think thinking about how licenses, free software licenses protect communities, it's easier to see this in the case of copyleft licenses like the AGPL or the GPLv2, GPLv3. The whole design of that kind of license is obviously to preserve the freedom of the software that's released under that license to prevent it from being proprietized, turned into proprietary software. So it's interesting to ask whether non-copyleft licenses, which are of course the other main type of license tool used in free software, also serves a kind of community protection function. And I think it is harder, at least thinking about it right now, to make that argument. I mean, I think advocates of non-copyleft licenses would probably say that the decision to use those licenses preserves the values of particular communities. But I'm not sure it's not really symmetrical with the way we think about copyleft licenses.
The other threat that I think it's worth talking about centralization and about the move away from running your own software. It's relatively easy to clone Twitter, but that doesn't mean that Twitter's monopoly over information distribution can be limited. So I think that's a real threat that we need to be aware of, and we need to think about not just how that threatens people's ability to communicate and those sort of things, but also the threat that poses to the software that we're using if it's only used by a few obscure people and the big powerful players are using proprietary software.
Okay, do we have any questions from the audience? One there, one here.
My question is to the panel as a whole. In 2016, we saw discussions by the Productivity Commission to talk about the role of intellectual property rights for software and whether reform was required. My question to all of you is, what reform would you like to see or do you believe is necessary in order to protect the free and open source software community?
I mean, I don't really have a good answer. I think that the problems are much more cultural than they are legal, and that it's important to continue to use the legal tools at our disposal, and it's important to continue to lobby for things like reductions in software patents and reductions in copyright terms and other things that restrict freedom. But I think the threat is much more existential than that. It's much more about policy and culture than it is about law.
I can imagine, and I sometimes think about fairly what are, you know, fortunately, unfortunately or not, far-fetched reforms of copyright law, patent law. So for example, I mean, you can imagine legislating the copyleft principle. It's not at all, you know, if you think that there should be a right to proprietary software, that's obviously something that you're going to be opposed to. In I think most of present day societies that have any kind of software industry, that is the status quo. So that's why it's kind of a far-fetched reform idea, but it's not at all, I mean, there are good policy arguments for why this could be legislated. And essentially, you know, I said that we were using licenses as legal tools. The licenses, and this is kind of true of licenses and contracts and agreements in general, they're kind of ways of creating a kind of legislation outside of the legislation system. It's sort of correcting for a failure of the legislature, so an absence of statutes or an absence of regulations. So that's kind of a way of looking at what a license like the GPL does. It creates its own sort of internal set of legal rules that that the legislature has failed to do because they have a restrictive copyright regime. So I think I think we should continue to think about radical, far-fetched reforms of copyright law and patent law and other kinds of laws that affect software as well. I don't really have a lot of hope that there will be any significant reforms of that sort in the near future. I'm sure long term we will probably, I think we're moving in that direction, but that's going to take a very long time.
And I would add to that, the courts create its own set of things, and the things that we can do within the courts are limited because I think this is the case in most Western nations, that the courts tend to favor the frequent litigator. The more money you have, the more familiar you are with the system. If you're in there every week, you get to know the judges. And so any kind of small reforms that we do are an attempt to ameliorate that situation where, so in the patent sphere, you might say perhaps we could slightly narrow the scope of patentability, or we might decide to slightly shorten the terms of patents, or we might make it slightly more difficult to get patents in certain areas on certain technologies, or we might look at ways that we impact things that happen in the courts. We might say there's a certain amount of discovery, which is the questions that plaintiffs and defendants send back and forth, which is often a really, really costly process, we could put caps on that. Or, so all of these are kind of small things, but what they kind of revolve around this larger problem of we have extremely large companies with a team of lawyers that are very big, that basically anything they go in, they will eventually get the result that they want. They might lose a case here and there, but eventually there will be, I don't want to sound, usually I'm at least partly optimistic, but it's, all of those small reforms revolve around that larger idea of kind of centralized larger corporations playing in that space. So I don't know if that's a good answer. That's what I'm saying.
I don't really spend a lot of time thinking about, what the law should be. I advise a lot of, I should start with, I am not a lawyer, but I talk about a variety of legal things with people, and I usually say, figure out what you want to do first, and then figure out how you can do it with the law. Don't start with the law. I was talking, not so much a FOSS tool, but I was talking to someone who wanted to start maybe a business or a nonprofit, and have a complicated structure because she's into similar values to FOSS people, but different business. I'm like, well, start with what you want to do and then figure out how you should incorporate. Don't start with the law first and then figure out how you fit into it.
Thank you. There was one there, and then there, and then there.
Thank you. So my question is regarding a point that Michael raised. So in the past, when somebody, you know, gave you software, you got all those copyleft rights, right? Because making it available to you essentially meant distributing it to you. Nowadays, in the world of hosted services, that means, yeah, the software is available to you, but we are not sharing any of the code, right? Because we are not actually giving you the software. And that's becoming more and more common. I mean, server-side computing has always existed, but most of the software out there that we contribute to is actually licensed on terms like GPL, LGPL, whatever, and that basically is, it doesn't apply if somebody is, you know, doing their own thing. And in some cases that's good, but it's also proliferating. And I was wondering what your thoughts are. Should we all switch to that federal, you know, what are your thoughts of making sure our freedoms apply in a cloud world?
Can you share that, Mark? Yeah.
Did you want to?
I was just chuckling because Bradley is over there, and he's often. I think you've stopped saying in your talks that we should all, or do you still say that we should all switch to Affero GPL? I mean, I'm sure you still believe it.
I still believe that.
Yeah, I mean, my view on that is I think if that's what projects and developers, individual developers, want to do, I think that's fine. I don't see that. That hasn't been happening much so far. So I think it's something that developers are going to have to decide.
I might just add to that we think about things in terms of copyright licensing, not because there's some inherent part of copyright licensing that's relevant, but because that's the tool that we've been using for the last, for the last 25 years. And maybe we should be thinking about other tools as well. We should be thinking about terms of service, and we should be thinking about mandatory federation and about things like access to data initiatives, which require people to have APIs. Those type of regulatory actions, I think, are going to be much more powerful than saying, because when it comes to it, the software sometimes isn't the hard part of these services. If we have the great tool that is only available under AGPL, that doesn't mean that the company will use that tool and suddenly the service will be open. They'll just write their own tool.
I think related to that, as I mentioned, Cadasta does license our software that way, but our terms of service are also very important because communities are gathering data about themselves to try to get legal rights to the land they live on. So we could easily offer a service and have our software be open and say we own your data in our terms of service, which is not what we do. It explicitly says that the data is always theirs. And that was really important to us, and actually very difficult to work through with the lawyers that we were working with, because like, why would you ever want to do that? But we've been very explicit about that because we shouldn't have rights to that data.
That is awesome. I think I would add, like, just the thinking about terms of service and things that in US under the DMCA, we have tended to sort of give those terms force of law, which is really, really problematic. So I agree there are other tools that we should be looking at for certain, but I don't have a whole lot more to add there.
Thanks. I think there was another question here.
I was going to ask, to what extent do you think the patent provisions in GPL v3 and Apache 2, what impact do you think they're having?
They certainly do have an impact. Companies that own patents. Most companies that own patents that think about the issue of what licenses cover software that they want to consume or not, or projects that they want to contribute or not, think pretty carefully about what the implications of those provisions on their portfolios. So I think I'm not sure. So with GPLv3. So it's easier to talk about the Apache license here. So there are a lot of projects that you see multiple corporations, many of them owning patents, contributing to that are using the Apache license today. At least, I don't know if it's numerically a lot, but these are very, from where I sit at least, very prominent, commercially significant projects. And I think I'm not sure that the details of those provisions matter as much as that the knowledge that there is a patent license grant explicitly in the license has an effect on shaping behavior of those companies. I think they sort of know at the outset that they're giving up a certain amount of their ability to assert patents around that code base. And so I'm not sure. I think that the reaction to GPLv3 is similar, but I think it's been less. GPLv3 is less widely used in that kind of project. So there are certainly a lot of GPLv3 projects out there that patent-owning corporations contribute to. But I think in those cases, it's more like they sort of have a significantly strong business need to contribute that any objections they might have to GPLv3. And that might not be just based on the patent provisions, it might be because they don't like strong copyleft licenses, are sort of overcome by the need to contribute to that project. So I think it's a mixed thing, but I think that on some level, the patent provisions provide a kind of way of signaling that corporations contributing collectively to a given project are going to adhere to a certain kind of set of standards of behavior around their use of patents, which is kind of like the way standards agreements with patent license terms work.
Do any of you have anything to add to that?
That's pretty thorough.
Yeah, it was pretty good. Thanks, Richard. I think Bradley, you had a...
So I like that you mentioned that we're focusing and have focused historically a little too much on licensing of copyrights in particular as a tool, mainly because it's the tool we've used. I suppose, given that it's an area of my expertise, it might be surprising to hear me say that. But I've generally looked at all the different legal tools we have available. And one of the ones that Kate mentioned a few minutes ago is the tool of formation of organizations and the structures we form organizations for to do our work. I have obviously a pretty US-centric view about how we do it, and I observe, at least in the United States, we've got roughly three types of structures that people have been forming around open source. C3s, like where I work at Conservancy under the IRS, US IRS tax code. C6s, like the Linux Foundation. And then there's Mozilla, which is basically a completely unique structure of a C3 owning an extremely large for-profit corporation underneath it. Those are the three structures I still continue to see. I'm interested in Linux Australia, for example, as their structure, because it's in Australia and it maybe has something to offer as a legal tool. But can you all comment on what you see as the legal tool of organizational formation and how that can be used to help advance software freedom?
Because I have the mic, I'll start. So I think that Conservancy, your organization, Karen's organization, has made a pretty good argument for, at least in the US context, the benefit of the charitable model for preserving the nonprofit, the kind of natural nonprofit orientation and charitable nature of free software community. So even without these kinds of these forms of organizations, a project can have, as I see it at least, a kind of charitable character. But organizations like Conservancy, as I see it, can use their, the features that they have under the U.S. And state law systems for nonprofits and the tax law to sort of cement that that commitment to a charitable purpose. So very valuable for many projects. I'm not sure if it's as important for all projects. But I'm not sure I see the same benefit for trade associations. I think there's obviously a strong interest in trade associations. There are some very well-funded trade associations in open source software, like the Linux Foundation and the OpenStack Foundation, the Eclipse Foundation. I'm not sure that the function that they're serving is what I would think of as protecting. I'm not sure if it's a protection function. I mean, maybe I'm just not. I'm using a too narrow a definition of protection. It may be that they serve to kind of preserve or at least encourage the collaborative nature of certain projects that might otherwise get too sort of lopsided in terms of like or too concentrated in the organizations that are contributing to them. So if that's also a kind of protection of the collaborative model, the trade associations perhaps play that sort of role.
I'm going to be a bit cheeky, and at the risk of offending our guests from the United States, there is a very US-centric kind of undertow, I guess, to a lot of this intellectual property issues, and also the C3s and C6s. And so it's interesting, Brett. Yeah, you said Linux Australia. Linux Australia is a. Yeah, right. So in terms of you know, there's different legal structures for organizations, but then there's also, you know, different intellectual property models. And we also talked about, you know, working with the state, against the state, or despite the state. And sometimes I kind of wonder if we get a little bit tangled up in the kind of intellectual property, I guess, you know, ocean we're swimming in, and could we be pushing back on that more? That was really a ramble and not a question. So back to the panel on some of that detail. Michael.
I mean, I think that you're right. We do tend to get tied up in what the regulations say in any particular place. But there's a lot of international consistency, in particular among Western nations. Things like the Berne Convention and TRIPS and, you know, other trade agreements which guarantee similar enforcement mechanisms for copyright and patent.
Yeah, but
protection.
They've still been imposed by the US in a lot of those cases.
Yeah, but even if the US wasn't using its like legal might to do that or treaties to do that, by its economic might, we would be subject to those rules. So I think, and you can see as we develop more and more international treaties, we see the rise of the multinational corporation and the investor-state dispute settlement regimes, which are all about giving protection to non-state actors because those are the people who can supersede that state power. But I think we have to recognize that we are indeed subject to these regimes. I will just briefly mention on the organizational point that in the Australian context, charitable formation is much, much harder, and becoming tax deductible is almost impossible. I note the Open Australia Foundation is has income tax deductible status as a library, but otherwise, organizations like Linux Australia and others tend to be essentially corporations formed with a non-profit clause in their constitution as opposed to anything else. And I think that that hasn't meant a great reduction in the amount of support or that those organizations have seen. I think the challenge is always about building a groundswell of people rather than necessarily being about the amount of money available. Also helps that in Australia we have a costs rule where if you win litigation, you get at least some of your costs back. So that tends to work better than the United States.
So the OpenStreetMap Foundation is actually a nonprofit corporation in the UK. And I don't know much about when other organizations decided to incorporate, but most of the ones I'm involved in, it was just someone lived there and did the paperwork. and we've discussed moving the OSMF casually. Brexit's one of the reasons for this, because a lot of our donations are in US dollars and euros, and being incorporated in the UK was just sort of something that happened that the board of directors has since inherited over the past 10 years. For the humanitarian OpenStreetMap team, which I started, which is a C3, we had no discussion about where to incorporate. I just knew that I could go down to the business office in Washington, D.C., and we could have a bank account a day later so we could receive a check. So I think as more information's out there, maybe people will be more thoughtful, but sometimes it's just very practical. I've never started an organization as anything but the impetus was someone wants to give us money, how do we do it? So.
Yeah. And the only thing I would add to that, well, in addition to like, sorry, we export all of our crummy IP stuff. Perhaps the next thing we should be looking at is if we're going to fight international corporations and their efforts to harmonize patents and copyrights around the world, then perhaps we need to be more international in the way that we think about building our own organizations. And I don't mean just like, let's not have a 501c3, but maybe let's have a 501c3 that is connected to a similar type of organization in Australia and you know, everywhere else that is impacted.
And you can look at more traditional nonprofits and how they do that. And some of them have a lot more money. But if you would look at like Doctors Without Borders or Greenpeace, where there's offices around the world, and how that works, where they're not necessarily just incorporated and structured in one place, but in some cases you're talking about billions of dollars and versus, you know, the OpenStreetMap Foundation, our budget last year was 70,000 pounds. So, you know, we're not going to go incorporate all over the world.
But one follow-up, and that is, we talked about government, we talked about the big corporates and the industry associations, and we're sort of touching on what that community piece is, and obviously community nonprofits and associations and all that sort of stuff. You sort of work in kind of in tension with each other and in harmony with each other at different points. I wonder if you've got thoughts on what that community effort piece means for protecting FOSS. What's the community effort bit? What do we mean when we talk about that?
I will say that I think one of the things we need to be talking to people who are not in these rooms and how endless copyright and how restrictive and frivolous patenting impacts their lives too. I feel like it's very abstract for a lot of people, and so it's really, you know, it feels like we have a finite number of people that call their elected official and it's like, oh, we're talking about this particular reform, and they're like, yeah, everyone's worried about like healthcare and water and stuff, and you just called me with this like arcane software issue that took me 10 minutes to understand, so okay. So I don't know if we need to talk about it more, or we need to talk about it better, or whatever it is, but I don't think we can do it with the percentage of citizens of any nation that we have so far.
So is it fair to say that one of the threats FOSS faces is that most people don't understand or care about it?
So, and maybe this is, I usually apply the don't talk politics at the Christmas table with my family, and they know what I do, but my sister is a proprietary software developer who is incentivized, gets a bonus for every patent she's able to successfully get. And sometimes convincing your own family can be the hardest thing. I certainly can't imagine how I could convince her that doing something else might be a better path, because she just looks towards the, oh, I get money every time I am able to successfully file a patent. So.
Yeah, I don't want to be like overly pessimistic, but I think advocates of reform of copyright law and patent law other than like really kind of like very small incremental things, mostly around patent law, they've just failed to make the case to the average citizen. That's certainly true of what I see in the US, and I'd be pretty surprised if it's different in other Western countries. The case just hasn't been made. So I think it's probably worse in the US in the sense that I think there's an extra bit of cultural support for some of these traditional forms of I'll use the term intellectual property. So like, you know, the support for fairly strong or entrenched patent regimes, which we still have despite some, you know, some recent developments in case law in the US. This is partly due to the successful tying of support for patent law to you know, all these American attitudes towards traditional property ownership and you know, all this cultural baggage around inventors and it's so deeply entrenched in the U.S. that I think it would take a pretty major you know, cultural shift to really affect that to the point where we start to see policy changes. So I think actually it's more likely that we're going to see change happen outside the U.S. and in other countries. And I don't know if Australia would be one of them, but I think the U.S. has a particular problem in this area because of the way that these particular legal regimes have been tied to all these really deeply held cultural attitudes.
I was just going to say, the people who've been making the case have been doing so on the basis that the people to be convinced need to understand the technicalities, and that has been totally unsuccessful, and I agree with everything you just said.
I'd never before considered the formation of an organisation as a legal tool that we could try and help improve, and so that was really interesting. And I'm at the Open Australia Foundation, and we're a registered charity and as a digital library and have tax deductibility status and wouldn't be able to operate in the same way without that. So it is really essential and has enabled us to make a whole lot of open source software. And that made me think of a policy of an Australian political party that's designed to support the arts, another kind of area where people are altruistically making stuff and putting it out there into the world, whereby, similarly to the tax deductibility status, that you'd classify artistic production under however you classify work that people can get a living wage from in Australia through New Start, so they don't have to go and look for jobs all the time but can claim welfare. And I wonder if anyone has thought about trying to get open source software contributions similarly classified in Australia or anywhere else in the world so that people could actually have a living wage and work on open source projects. You know, just a crazy idea.
It's interesting that you mentioned that. There's actually someone running local to me in Massachusetts, not my district, but Brianna Wu, who people may have heard of from the internet. But she is running for office in Massachusetts, and one of the things she's really interested in doing is setting up funds for the state to pay for free software. I don't know how many people from the Massachusetts delegation will join her in that stance as a congressperson, but I can definitely call mine. I think it's a really interesting idea because that we get to this all the time. Like if you have to make proprietary software at work, then you know, to get paid, then you can't make free software. So and people do have to eat. Like, you know, you can eat less for a while, but that's not a particularly long-term strategy, so.
I had a co-founder at an organization who was on welfare in Europe while we were starting it, and there was quite a bit of conflict between the two of us sometimes when trying to make decisions that also involved our finances, because I had nothing and was not eligible for anything versus he wasn't in amazing financial shape, but he could feed his family. So it was just seeing how we could think differently about things because of how our governments supported or didn't support us in different ways. They were in France.
I would be careful about the arts model for two reasons. Firstly, if you take a new start allowance, you have to be available for work. And obviously, if you were not working on free software, you're not available for work. The second point would be that the taxation situation in Australia around art is very complex, because it's all about you have created something from nothing, and at some point that will have a capital value. And how do we set up your tax affairs so that when that capital value is realized, that the government gets a fair share of that? And one of the issues with software, if you treated it like art, was that that capital value of that software, if you were included in the Red Hat distribution, you could fairly argue was a few million dollars, and you would be responsible for the 30% of that for your taxation, without having actually seen any income for it. But that would still be counted as your asset as the copyright holder. So I would be cautious about taking, saying, let's treat this thing as the arts. I think you'd be much better off just treating software as software with its own set of attributes around it.
I'll pick up on that and say that I agree we should be thinking sui generis. We should be thinking about software as its own thing, and it's not a great idea to continue to apply analogies after analogies after analogies. Having said that, I think we can solve those issues in policy implementation, and it is good that we're now starting to recognise the need to support especially core internet services that are free software, but a whole range of free software. I'd recognise that having a volunteer maintainer isn't necessarily sustainable.
Hi, Hanari Deegan from the Open Australia Foundation, that was set up as a digital library when we first started. That was a hack. Luckily, the charity system in Australia has changed, and we are now advancing culture. So if you are looking to set up a charity or you're classified as a charity in Australia, I'd have a look at it again and see whether maybe you could get reclassified. So that was a hack on the legal system to allow us to set up as a charity and allow us to operate and create public good, like open source software and changing democracy. The GPL also was a hack, a legal hack, right? Let's write a contractual document, a license, an unlicense almost, right? That says that all those things that you normally get with a license, like restrictions, you actually get freedoms. So my question, because I really like Luke said, the discussion about setting up organizations so that we can sustainably create free goods, what other hacks do you know about, have you heard about, or can you think of to legal systems for setting up organizations, creating licenses, whatever, that we could apply right now so that we can create changes to the law and the way the systems work, including our economic systems, because I see that as a huge problem. What are the different kind of hacks we could do now that would allow us to change the world for a better place for free software?
I mean, I'm happy to start with a couple. One is I think the Cadastro Foundation is doing great work. And that's really important in liberating land data. That's actually, it's if you'll pardon, not very sexy work, but it's actually really important to the structure of society. I think that, you know, I've tried to leverage freedom of information in the past and other administrative forms of review. Not very successful, but my view is that the best solution is an actual solution, and is actual change in policy, regulation, etc. But in the meantime, whenever you see a hole, tear at it.
I would say, so I work at the Open Invention Network, and we do a defensive patent pool. So instead of waiting for patents to disappear, we decided we would try and get as many people as possible to sign a mutual non-aggression pact. I'd love to see that go to like 20 other industries. Nobody's taken me up on that yet. If anyone wants to hire a consultant to set up a defensive patent pool, let me know. And I would be happy to do that. But to your point about like policy change, I think sometimes you have to pilot something outside of the legal system, not like illegal, that's not what I'm saying, definitely not on a recording, but sometimes you have to pilot something like outside of official channels and then you may hope to get it in. It's we see that sometimes in other kinds of areas of activism, like, you know, people may do an individual boycott of like some particular regime or some particular type of product that they find harmful, and then may at some point convince like their state government or their local government to also boycott that product or regime. So there is a historical path for doing something outside of policy and then bringing it in as official later.
And I think that's happened. If you look at OpenStreetMap, we started because it was impossible to get free map data in the United Kingdom, and then had this broader goal of a free map of the entire world. When it started being used for disaster response and international development, we just started mapping. And eventually the World Bank and governments had to talk to us because our map data was better than theirs, and also better than Google. Because, for example, the World Bank was working with Google to map sub-Saharan Africa and having mapping parties at the World Bank. It's like, well, if your goal is to reduce poverty, how is creating proprietary data with a large corporation doing that? And so we were able to help change that. There's a policy within the World Bank now that communities should have access when creating data to data about themselves. And it very much relates to OpenStreetMap data and how that needs to be free for those groups. And we just started doing it. We didn't really think of how we were going to interface with these large organizations. And I know that doesn't work for everything, but it was quite successful with maps, at least.
So just for the recording, this gentleman over here said the nice thing about OpenStreetMap data is that you don't have to ask anyone for permission. An example is Adelaide. A bunch of people went out and started mapping and getting that data and filling those gaps. Thanks. Bradley's got a question here.
So with regard to the point you made about US-centric nature of a lot of these things, I think it's a really important point. And I actually think I phrased my question poorly last time, because I was trying to point out that most of the structures we have used for organizations have been a little too much US-centric. And I think we rely on our international colleagues to tell us when some of the structures in open source and free software are being somewhat culturally imperialistic from the US. It is a problem that I think those of us who are thoughtful in the US are aware of and want to be told about. I can only speak for myself on this point, but I realized on the plane this is my last international trip where I won't, for about 4 years, where I won't have to constantly feel like I need to apologize for the US. So come around Friday, you can come to me and get a really big apology for the US. But I'd like to have another, just a few more days before I have to start doing that, because it's going to be a long time.
I'll hold you to that, Bradley. I think there was one question here, but you've asked one. Was there someone who hadn't asked a question yet who wanted to before I do a repeat? You? Okay, we'll come back to you.
All right, so this sort of relates to what the Open Australia guys were saying, but kind of to put a slightly different spin on it, like alternative ways, like copyright kind of seems broken for software. Like, what's an alternative? Like, I know I have some ideas that are crazy, but change the motivation. Like, is there something, rather than hacking on the system, is there an alternative, and is, or has it been tried anywhere? A bit like that arts funding, I think we proposed it, but has something like that been tried?
I don't know if you mean something more robust than, like, so Creative Commons is one example of that. It's, you know, and that's for specific kinds of works. I think we need to keep creating those structures for other things. So, you know, we have the copyleft hack for software. We have Creative Commons for creative works. And then I know that people are working on looking at how to do hardware design modeling, so open hardware and that community and things like that. So I think we may just have to like keep recreating those things for each individual area, because they, you know, what happens when we kludge on one type of tool onto another area is sort of the problem we have now with software. So we don't, maybe in our fixes, we don't need to recreate that.
Yeah, to that, and to also the, someone was asking before about legal hacks comparable to copyleft. I see that, I mean, there have been a lot of experiments to try to extend the ideas behind copyleft and kind of like free software licensing more generally to patents, to trademarks. There's some, you know, interesting stuff that Wikimedia Foundation did around trademarks a few years ago. I feel like all of this, though, is it just didn't really, I mean, the stuff that's sort of getting away from copyright and using, trying to use a patent-based solution or trademark-based solution to sort of copy what was done with copyleft licensing. Hasn't really caught on. I think that there are just some there are some things you can do with copyright that just don't work quite as well with these other regimes. So I think I still see this as a highly experimental area. I see, for example, that in free software legal circles, there's a lot more interest in trademarks now than there were 5 years ago, let alone, you know, 10 years ago. There was very little attention being paid to this. So I think that some of that is resulting in some interesting ideas around how projects can use trademarks to achieve some of the kinds of social goals that maybe copyleft licensing would have achieved. But I think this is still very much in its infancy.
Okay, got a question here.
One final question for the panel. I guess you've talked about the issues with the patent system, and my question would be whether perhaps another mechanism for protecting open source works is the use of competition law or antitrust law in the United States in order to leverage certain situations where parties, big developers, are using patents or copyrights in a monopolistic fashion.
So again, at least in the U.S., I know there's a keen understanding that patents on software have contributed greatly to a lot of monopolistic behavior. Unfortunately, the agency, the Federal Trade Commission, which is usually tasked with carrying out, like, you know, prosecuting or stopping monopolies from happening, which has produced like 700 pages of reports on the impact of software patents on monopolies and consolidation of power in the marketplace. Unfortunately, they're not exactly quite the right agency to do that. They don't have quite the same mandate that one would have for physical goods. And so the law hasn't really caught up such that they feel empowered to act. There was some, after their second 350-page report, there was some federal action and statements from our president at the time, Obama, saying, you know, like pushing for some amount of patent reform, but again, it was of the type that we were talking about, which was like really small stuff. Like let's make discovery a little less expensive. Let's make it a little less appealing to be a patent troll.
I might just add, from the Australian context, there's specific provisions in the Competition and Consumer Act that prevent any of that from applying to patent-related activities, or activities that are protected by patent. There is, I think, a Productivity Commission recommendation in its most recent IP report was to eliminate that protection. But even so, I think a big part of the, and going back to something I said earlier, I think a big part of the reason that we get these monopolies forming is not necessarily about use of protected software, it's about being first to market, network effects, hosted services, that is creating you know, the walled playgrounds in which we're all expected to play.
I think I had, was it a comment or a question that you had before? It was a comment. Well, I might come back to that. If you've got a question? Okay, so before we go to comments, what I want to do, because we've only got about just over 5 minutes left, I want to give our panelists each a sort of final word. So I've got space for one more question before we do that. Nope, okay. So I'm going to go over to you, final word. So refreshing on what our topic was, the future of community efforts to protect free and open source software using legal tools. Now I know I'm a whole lot more informed now than I was at the beginning and have a much better understanding and that sense of what legal tools are, about the kinds of threats that we face and some of the mechanisms that we have as a community and communities to start to address those. So I want to throw to my fabulous panel, and you've probably got about a minute each, to just final words and calls to action. Deb.
Okay, I know I said a lot of pessimistic stuff, but I do think that events like this give us an opportunity to have conversations about organizing internationally for the same goals of software freedom and fighting giant proprietary monopolistic corporations. So I don't know why I'm on my commie soapbox today, but I am. So I hope we'll continue to look for ways to organize across national lines. Thanks.
Thanks, Deb.
Something I'm excited for, which is much more sort of practical, is we talked a lot about the different types of legal tools. We didn't talk about data licensing too much, but the open database license and Creative Commons CC by SA are not currently compatible, but they have the same intent, and a lot of data is licensed under one or the other. And there's some movement to at least figure out a path to have some level of compatibility. And I'm excited about that because it'll make things like importing government data into OpenStreetMap hopefully easier. I mean, it's great when communities go ride their bikes with their GPSs in map areas, but sometimes it can be redundant. So I'm excited to hopefully sometime this year for that to be a thing. Thank you.
Thanks, Kate.
I think it's all about community organization and about building communities, as the other two have said already. I think that is what drives change. And I think that probably the most important thing is to think about what Pia said this morning, which is we need to be making conscious choices about where we go from here. I see far too often that we make arguments by analogy, or we say that this is how things have been done, so that's how they will continue to be done. My belief is that by saying, hey, what we're doing here is actually new and different, and maybe we need a new and different regime for handling that, and then lobbying through community groups to build that.
Awesome, thanks, Michael. And Richard, final word.
Yeah, so I would go back to something I was saying earlier. I think that we should not be afraid of thinking big and long-term. And I think that legislative, regulatory solutions are maybe something that we should be looking at more than we have. We've been focused so much on in free software and free culture communities on kind of developing licensing types of approaches and similar approaches, sort of private. What we'd say legally is private approaches versus public approaches. Let's start thinking of more public approaches, and I think related to that is we obviously need to, proselytize more. I think this is still a very narrow kind of area in terms of the degree of public support and knowledge of free software and the whole legal underpinning of free software. If we continue to spread knowledge about this area and all the analogous kind of areas that may be more accessible, like Creative Commons licensing may actually be more familiar to many people now than free software or open source licensing, and that's a way of building a bridge to increase knowledge and support for progressive or even subversive use of certain legal regimes to help software. So if we continue to normalize these various closely related areas of use of legal tools across both software and non-software kinds of content, I think that's the way of sort of gradually building the potential for support for real change, which I think is going to have to happen at the legislative level.
Thank you very much. We are right on time. Please give our panel a huge round of applause.